It is also possible to have a series of slabs where there is a section that is parallel to each other. In this example, we've got Q coming in from left to right, and we've got on the left, obviously, the hot temperature, and on the right, we have the cold temperature. In this instance, I've included a section for the convection layer on the left and on the right. As usual, the heat flows perpendicular to the area, and it's going to flow through slab 1. It's going to flow through slab 2 and slab 3 that are parallel sections, slab 4, and out through the convective layer on the right-hand side. In our calculation so far, we've always assumed that the heat flow is linear. In order to keep this assumption, we are going to look at this from two different angles. The first of these I'm going to call scenario 1. In scenario 1, we're going to assume that the surfaces normal to the direction of the heat flow are isothermal. What this means is that the entire length of slab 1 and slab 4 are going to have the same temperature. So what this means is if the surface is normal to the direction of flow isothermal as drawn in red, the temperature throughout the length of 1 and throughout the length of 4 are going to be constant. If we have to draw this as a thermal resistance diagram, what this means is that we are going to now have our first resistance, which will be the convection. We will have conduction for slab 1, so that's the hot side convection, HH. The first slab, the second slab will then be next, but because it is parallel, we will now join it with slab 3 in a parallel configuration. And lastly, we will have slab 4 as our final configuration in our conduction, followed by the final convection term on the cold side. The second scenario we have, scenario 2, is if we assume that the surface is parallel to the heat flow, so that is the surface there, is adiabatic. So that means that no heat is going to flow through that line between slab 2 and slab 3. In this assumption, what we are also saying is effectively that the heat transfer in the system is going to be straight through the top and straight through the bottom. So because of that, we're not going to have any difference or heat flow across either of slab 1 or slab 2. So we are going to have different temperature profiles in K1 and K4 rather. If we have to draw this one in a thermal resistance diagram, we are now going to break this up entirely. And we're going to have two separate branches for each of the convection, the conduction of slab 1, slab 2, and slab 4. So that is on the top for the hot 1, 2, and 4. And on the bottom, we again have the convection for the hot slab 1. We now have slab 3, again for slab 4. And then we can join them again on the right. And sorry, I've left something off here. We should have the 2 as well for the convection on the cold side. In order to solve these systems now, we're going to do exactly the same thing as we do in electrical circuits, where we are going to take the series components, so there in scenario 1, the RH, the R1, the R4 and RHC, so the resistance of those things, and we are going to add them. If we have sections in parallel, we are going to take those as 1 over the resistance, or add 1 over the resistance, and then invert it. So for example, for this section R2 and R3, we're going to take 1 divided by R2, the inverse, plus 1 over R3, the inverse, and invert that. That we will then add to the series sections. If we're looking at scenario 2, we are going to have to add up all of these series sections on the top and all of those on the bottom. We'll then take 1 divided by that plus 1 divided by the bottom section, and we will again invert that. If we write this all out in full now and we start on the left hand side, we can see that the total resistance is equal to the series section of the convective plus R1 plus, as we said, the parallel section, which we're going to have to invert, add, and invert again. We remember that Q is equal to delta T over R, so we can replace that as a term of delta T divided by, and then we have 1 divided by the convective heat transfer on the hot side multiplied by the area, plus the L1 and K1A terms for rows 1 and 4 at the bottom here. But now we have to invert the KA and the L2, which we're doing in the middle here, add, and then don't forget the minus 1. And sorry, this is a bit messy. I'll neaten it up now. On the right-hand side for scenario 2, we do the same thing where the total resistance is equal to 1 divided by, as we said, the entire series added together, plus 1 divided by the entire section on series to the power of minus 1. When we start putting this into a Q equation, Q is equal to delta T on R, it gets rather messy. So there we have our delta T divided by, and now we have 1 divided by all of these individual terms here. So there's 1 divided by HA, the convective heat transfer hot, plus L1, K1, L2, K2, 4, and then the convective on the other side. And we'll do exactly the same thing for the bottom string of that thermal resistance that we had at the top. Okay, so as I said, we neaten this up quickly. Here we have scenario 1, and you can see for that we have the value of Q, and at the bottom we have the resistance term. If we do the same and neaten up for scenario 2, we've now got that more complicated scenario underneath for the resistance. And please don't forget, this is written out neatly in the notes, so you can go and have a look and see what it looks like there.